A coroutine can be thought of as being a function that is executed in intervals. These functions work with special yield statements which return the code execution out of the function. Then, when the function continues, execution begins again right from where it left off. Let's take a look at an example coroutine. To start, let's take a look at the coroutine itself, which we have called my coroutine. The first thing to notice is its return type, IEnumerator. This means that the function can return anything which implements the IEnumerator interface. There is more to returning from a coroutine than usual, however, as you will see in a moment. Next, we see that it takes a transform as a parameter. We are then starting a while loop which will continue until the distance between the object and the target is less than 0.05. Within the loop, we are firstly lerping the object's position between itself and the target position. Then we have the line yield return null. This is what allows a coroutine to work the way it does. What this means is that when this line of code is executed, it will yield execution of the function and return a null IEnumerator. The code will resume at this point at the time dictated by the return value. Since the return value is null, that means the coroutine will resume after the next update. Since the coroutine will resume at the end of the loop condition will then be re-evaluated. If the transform has not reached the target yet, it will lerp closer to the target, and again, it will yield until the next update. Once the loop condition is no longer evaluated to true, the loop will exit and the coroutine will print "reached the target" to the console. At that point, the coroutine will yield again, but this time it's returning an instance of the waitForSeconds class. The constructor is called using the new keyword, and in this case, we're passing in 3 as a parameter. Predictably, the result of returning an instance of the waitForSeconds class is that the code will continue execution after the given number of seconds. After 3 seconds, the words "my coroutine is now finished" are printed to the console. At that point, we've reached the end of the coroutine and execution will finish. Now let's take a look at how to call a coroutine. We do so simply with the startCoroutine function. It takes a parameter of either a coroutine call or a string of the coroutine's name. The former call is the one we've shown here and is more advisable. However, if you use a call with a name string, then you can also call stopCoroutine to halt it prematurely. Now let's see this coroutine in action. We have attached the coroutine script to this little robot, and we have created a target object. When the scene is run, the robot moves towards its target, and when the robot reaches its target, the console displays the message. Then, 3 seconds later, the coroutine finishes with the second message. Note that we have created movement without using update or creating any timers. This is really excellent and makes our code more efficient. However, a real strength of coroutines is when they are combined with properties. Let's take a look at an example of that. In this scene, we have another robot. The robot has a properties and coroutines script on it. We also have a script called clickSetPosition attached to the environment. The properties and coroutine script has a public vector3 property called target that encapsulates the target field. Remember that when we allocate to the target property, we call the set function. The clickSetPosition script sets the target of an object with a properties and coroutine script on it to wherever we click in the environment. Back on the properties and coroutine script, let's see what happens when the target is set. First, we set the target field to the correct value. Then we stop any movement coroutines. It is important to note that stop coroutine only works with coroutines that have been started by the string call, as we are on the next line. This is the alternate way of calling start coroutine. We pass the name of the coroutine as a string, and then the parameter afterwards. Our movement coroutine is similar to the my coroutine from the last example. It simply lerps the cube's position towards a given target until it's close. The effect of having our script set up like this is that we have a moving game object without the need for an update function that polls for values every frame. Polling for values is something that reduces the efficiency of the code we write, and while we sometimes have to, it is something we should try to avoid.